Namaskar. Welcome to Vision of Asia, a voice of the community. I'm Kala Shankar. Today on Sunday, September 30th, 2018, in our special weekly one-hour edition of Vision of Asia, here are the highlights. Our report on dance drama Nandalala, a Jaipur literary festival at the Asia Society, an overseas Indian Congress meet at Utsav restaurant, a 5K walk run for the organization Vibha, the AIA annual gala, the India Festival by IALI, and cooking for a cause in Edison. So much is happening in our community, and today's Vision of Asia is packed with reports on various events. The program will continue right after the short break. Stay with us. The dance drama Nandalala mesmerized the audience at Queensborough Performing Arts Center last Friday. The team of 14 talented dancers originally trained by different gurus came together to play 56 characters related to the Sri Krishna Leela and left the audience spellbound. This was organized by the Aim for SEVA organization in order to raise funds for the projects initiated with the inspiration of Swami Dayananda Saraswati. Ashok Vyas has his report.
Talk to me a little bit about finding the right balance between being careful about what is expected by the dance form and the bow.
Yeah. So while doing any character, you have to completely get into the character and be the character. So the first thing is to think that you are Krishna, you are playing the role of Krishna, and whatever the scene is, you have to get into it completely. So when my guru taught the role to me, she told me what emotions are supposed to come out and what I'm supposed to show in my face. She also shows me how it has to be done. So I've taken all that in and performed that on stage.
Yes, it was a wonderful experience altogether, working with this wonderful team, with our guru. The very important point is all of us are not from the same dance school. We're from different dance styles, from different parts of the country back in India. So all of us to get together, and we worked for nearly 6 months to bring out this finesse in this production. Our teacher has logged for nearly 24 hours every day, choosing the songs and teaching each person, like Rohini was telling, each person's character has to be exactly that. And we've played multiple roles, so we need to differentiate those characters in our head and be as apt as possible. So it has been an internal journey for all of us to bond, to bring out the characters, to bring out the vibrancy of the production and do justice to the roles we've played.
You have this wonderful mukut on your head. How that works out in terms of getting to the comfort zone?
Actually, when we rehearse at class, it's an entirely different comfort zone because there's no lights on us, there's no jewelry, we're in our comfortable clothes. So we're definitely more confident back in class. But when we come on stage with especially few kiritams which require a lot of detail, they are quite heavy. So there it definitely is a hindrance to us to give our full 100%, but we definitely try to put in, and our guru always says, only if you give 1000% in class, at least 10% of that comes in stage.
It was wonderful working in this production because it was a multilingual production. It doesn't confine to the norms of the other productions we've done because it's multilingual, and although majority of this is Bharatanatyam, we've also taken and adapted from different styles of dance. So it was really new to take in the nuances, because I think usually when we're doing Bharatanatyam, we're so focused on that we fail to, you know, sometimes understand or comprehend the other nuances of the other forms. So I think that way is very enriching.
I have been part of Anita Ji's production since some years, and it was my luck that she again selected me to play the role of Lord Krishna. It's been a while she taught me how to portray this character. In this production, what I especially saw that how intellectually she choreographs each piece, how difficult the piece might be, how in a small capsule, how to bring in the best possible way to getting the story in audience mind, keeping the traditional dance in mind. Also, what happens when best technology, best dancers and best choreography with the best appearance comes together, how a beautiful production can be a mega hit.
The Jaipur Literary Festival has become the only literary festival of its kind. And now, the team works has worked towards hosting a Jaipur Literary Festival in different cities in America. Last week, the Asia Society hosted many literary figures, including Ambassador Navtej Sarna and Shashi Kapoor. ITV Gold supported the event, and our chairman, Dr. Sudhir Parekh, also shared his vision during the concluding session of the Jaipur Literary Festival at the Asia Society in Manhattan. Here's some highlights from that event.
I think it's an excellent development following on the JLF coming to Boulder as well as Houston. This will provide another window into Indian culture, into Indian literature for our American audiences. And I think this is something which builds upon the commonalities that India and the United States have together as two open democracies which have been interacting with each other over the ages. And then the company comes, they send their soldiers, the diamond is taken off to Leadenhall Street, which was the headquarters of East India Company. A former Prime Minister, Robert Peel, falls off a horse and the horse falls upon him and he dies. So that's also attributed to the Kohinoor. So all this bad luck begins to happen. Then comes the great exhibition of London, 1851, where the Kohinoor is displayed. It's displayed very badly. It's just put there, this large egg of a diamond. It doesn't shine. People come, they queue up the streets, look waiting to see it. They are disappointed.
First session was a conversation I had with William Dalrymple on the history of the Kohinoor diamond. I think it's one of the most famous diamonds in world history.
and we traced it how through the Mughal period, how it went to Nadir Shah, how it went to Abdali, how it went to Shah Shuja, then finally came to Maharaja Ranjit Singh.
Then a real battle began in the Darbar, and the third son, who was Sher Singh, he came, he took the diamond, he took the throne. He was, he didn't live too long. He was shot by the Sikhs, the Atariwalas and the Sandavalias, who were actually conspiring against him. He was shot, and the boy king, and that's where we come to the story, which was Daleep Singh.
We are very happy to associate with Isha Society and JLF to bring JLF to New York. Amazing array of speakers, all stars in their respective fields. And I strongly urge that people should follow JLF on social media and on the consulate media platforms, so that next time you are there in person to listen to these amazing writers from all over the world, with particular focus on India and various aspects of India and Indian literature. I think JLF is the world's largest literary festival, and we're very happy to bring it to New York.
The Brits came and they said, no, our books tell us that Muharram is a Shia thing. Out with the Sunnis, out with the Hindus, only the Shias will get to run the show. And soon enough, the sniping started from the Sunnis, and the first incidents of Sunni-Shia violence happened under British rule and not under Nawabi rule. Now, this kind of a tendency to want to control, to categorize, to classify, is common to all colonists. It's sort of, you know, the map and the museum are very much instruments of colonialism, and so is the census. So you use the census to ask people to identify themselves along the lines of categories you, as the colonizer, can understand, can classify, and can control. And that's where these monolithic Hindu-Muslim identities began to emerge and became internalized in the consciousness of Indians. It didn't help that after the revolt of 1857, the mutiny, as the British called it, we had also a very conscious effort to divide and rule. The famous memo from Elphinstone, who said that "Divide et impera" was the ancient Roman maxim, and it shall be ours. And with that, you had this increasing consciousness that ultimately culminated, after many stages I've described in the book, in partition. Now, whether we should today still be prisoners of all of these things, I strongly contest. A lot of good work being done by modern historians has established that the actual reality was very different. And there is so much evidence, not just anecdotal, but historically grounded evidence of the community's interpenetration, cooperation, not just coexistence, but going well beyond that, so that you have story after story of, let's say, Hindu temples being destroyed in natural calamities and Muslims coming to help rebuild it. You have Hindus thronging to Muslim shrines. You have the Dagar brothers singing Hindu devotionals. You have all of these elements of cultural exchange and mutuality, which are sought to be denied by this Hindu-Muslim binary narrative that I reject.
I would like to offer Asia Society, as well as Jaipur Literature Festival, to count on Mali Worldwide Media, our ITV, as well as count on Meet Maskari, and we are always with you and part of the history making. So please do a bigger function next year, and we are with you. Thank you.
So I would just like to take this moment for you to sort of reach out to the audience, especially to the Indian Malayali community, and just give your words of support and encouragement and anything that you want the NRI community to help right now with.
Sure. Well, the immediate crisis is now over, but I guess you could anathemize the whole thing in 4 R's. The first was rescue. There was an urgent need to actually save people who are marooned on tops of their houses.
Right.
There's been an extensive crisis of flooding in about 7 or 8 of our 14 districts.
Yes.
And many people were in dire straits. We had, fortunately, the Navy coming in, Army helicopters, the Coast Guard, and even ordinary fishermen, people who basically live below the poverty line, came out in their boats and saved people's lives. It was extraordinary. We have the rebuilding and reconstruction challenge, which is enormous, because the damage has been extensive. Mm-hmm. 50,000 homes have been destroyed or damaged. 39 bridges are down. 80,000 kilometers of roads were damaged.
Quite a devastation.
All of this, really decades of infrastructure built up in Kerala, will now have to be rebuilt. And that, I'm sorry to say, is what now looms ahead for many years to come.
How important is it right now for you to campaign for your voice now that we're going into 2019?
Well, obviously, I will be campaigning pretty much full time from the time I get back at the end of this week, or this weekend. Largely because there's no question in my mind and in the minds of everybody else who cares about India that the future of the country will be very severely impacted by the decisions made by the voters in the next election.
Right.
We have seen, sadly, an attempt to transform in many ways the nature of our country by a government which has unleashed or at least condoned a number of forces of bigotry and intolerance that should have no place in our society. We have seen the onset of phenomena that we hardly were conscious of before, of the so-called gau rakshaks, the cow vigilantes, the mob lynchings.
Yes.
These are kinds of episodes that have shaken many people's faith in the Indian Republican and the Indian secular democratic experiment to the core. And I think that we do need to stand up for decency and human values in our society. On top of that, this government was elected because it talked a good game economically, but it's not been able to deliver. Economic growth has slowed down. Jobs have not been created. We are seeing agriculture in a state of great distress, farmer suicides going up. We're looking at exports stagnating, manufacturing going down. It's a really unrelieved picture of gloom around. And one turns to one's voters and says, have Achhe Din come for you? The good days that were promised by this government. And if they haven't come, why do they deserve a second chance?
I would just like for you to reflect on this huge concept of, you know, India, Pakistan and the Muslim population and how they sometimes do get marginalized in India. You've been very vocal about this, and that's one of the biggest reasons Congress supporters have come up to you on that. I would just like for you to just give us a little bit of insight into that big concept.
There are two different issues. India, Pakistan is a relationship between two states. India and Indians Muslims are a question within our own society. India's Muslims are not Pakistanis, they're Indians.
Right.
And they have the rights of Indians and they should be allowed to flourish in our society just as anybody else of Hindu or Christian or any other faith.
Right.
But India, Pakistan, the problem unfortunately goes to the very nature of the Pakistani state. You see, in India, the state has an army.
Right.
In Pakistan, the army has a state.
The state, yes.
And the army controls pretty much everything there is in that society, including its government. They ran the country directly with a number of military coups for 32 years, but they also ran the country indirectly when they weren't directly in power by controlling how much the civilian government could do and not do, and by curbing the rights of the civilian government to actually make peace with India. Every time the civilian governments of the day engaged in a peaceful process with India, the military and their pet jihadis were unleashed to stop it.
Yeah.
So Mr. Vajpayee took a bus trip to Lahore in 1999. Within a few months, the attack on Kargil followed.
They did.
We had the issue of the peace talks in Agra. Within a few months, the attack on the Indian Parliament followed. We had a warm and peaceful attempt to dialogue between Mr. Zardari's government and the government of Dr. Manmohan Singh, and then 2611 followed. So every time that peace has been attempted, somebody in Pakistan has had a veto on it through the use of terror as an instrument of their designs. And to my mind, that is a problem that can only be solved within Pakistan.
You are watching Vision of Asia, Voice of the Community. We'll be right back after these messages. The Indian Overseas Congress organized a meet and greet with a number of Congress's 2019 Election Manifesto Committee, Professor M.V. Rajeev Gowda. Here's a report on that event.
We are here today hosting our leader, Rajeev Gowda, who's a member of Rajya Sabha, and he's also a member of Manifesto Committee. So today, agenda of the meeting today, so we have to discuss for the future पार्लियामेंट इलेक्शन जो इलेक्शन जो आ रही है पार्लियामेंट की उसके बारे में हम डिस्कस कर रहे हैं इंडियन ओवरसीज कांग्रेस के सभी मेंबर डिफरेंट स्टेट से आए हैं तो सभी लोग अपना अपना सुझाव देंगे तो उस पर राजीव गौड़ा जी विचार करके सभी विचारों को अपने मैनिफेस्टो में डालेंगे ये आज का एजेंडा है.
वी आर हेयर टुनाइट एट उत्सव रेस्टोरेंट इन मिडटाउन एंड इन डिनर इन द ऑनर ऑफ मिस्टर प्रोफेसर राजीव गौड़ा. So, and the next agenda is we will discuss for our 2019 coming elections, making more membership for our Indian National Overseas Congress, and how we can work together, and that's what we will discuss tonight. Thank you.
This is one of the new wings that has come up under the Congress President, Shri Rahul Gandhi, and we are here to welcome Professor Gowda and also seek his expertise and learn from him so that we in the IOC are better prepared to win 2019, which we are very keen to.
आज हमारे साथ में राज घोड़ा जो राज्यसभा के मेंबर है वो आए हुए हैं और 2019 के जो इलेक्शन के बारे में हम लोग मीटिंग करने वाले हैं अभी. सो ज़्यादा करके सारे स्टेट के लोग यहाँ पे आए हुए हैं. महाराष्ट्र के हैं, महाराष्ट्र अपना दिल्ली से भी है, पंजाब से है, यूपी से है, सारे लोग हम लोग मिले हुए हैं यहाँ पे उत्सव रेस्टोरेंट के अंदर. सो वी आर गोइंग टू डू वेरी मच क्लोजली मीटिंग विद द पीपल एंड वेरी सून वी आर गोइंग टू द विन ऑल द इलेक्शन. आई एम प्राउड ऑफ यू मिस्टर राज गौड़ा इज ए फ्रॉम राज्यसभा. सो थैंक यू सो मच एंड आई एम गुड लक टू एवरीबडी टू.
We are looking forward for the session with Rajeev Gowda MP from Karnataka, and we all respect IOC for the inclusiveness and secularism that it stands for, and we are we hope, you know, that Congress will come into power, and we all have to work hard for that in the coming years. For the next year, the Congress should come into power in the parliament.
So this evening it's an honor and privilege to be spending the evening with members of the Congress party overseas, and we have a range of people from different professions who come from different parts of New York City and its suburbs, and they're honoring me with a chance to engage with them on how to strengthen the Congress party and how to improve our prospects in the forthcoming election. I have been here as part of a delegation of MPs brought to America by FICCI, the Chamber of Commerce Association, and I'm at the end of a very, very intense and productive series of engagements in Berkeley, in San Jose, in Los Angeles, and in New York. Just before coming here, I gave a talk at Columbia University on electoral reforms, and essentially this evening we are gathered to reinforce our commitment to India, to the idea of India, which stands for inclusion, for celebration of diversity, for attention to those who are left behind. And this is what the Congress has always stood for and will continue to stand for as we basically take things forward, you know, under Sri Rahul Gandhi's leadership.
The Vibha organization Dream Mile Run and Walk race to benefit a brighter future for children was held recently at Skillman Park in New Jersey. ITV Gold supported the event. Take a look.
Really excited to be here to get the opportunity to get everybody warmed up. Thank you, Kair.
Oh, please.
This is an amazing cause. Thank you so much.
It is an annual event. This is our second year. We have more than 400 runners join us. Vibha is a non-profit organization helping underprivileged children in India and in the US as well. And it's going to be a great time.
I'm just amazed to see the crowd again this time. This is our second walk in New Jersey. I'm just waiting for, you know, the winners and people to get this over.
Vibha has raised 17, let me repeat that, $17 million that has impacted more than 2 million children. It also focuses on areas like healthcare, rescue and rehab, care for handicapped children, readiness, job readiness for the youth. It also supports disaster recovery efforts under extraordinary circumstances. Most recently, they have raised $120,000 for Kerala Relief. A big round of applause for Vibha and for what they are doing for all underprivileged children in India and everywhere else.
This year's Vibha Walk was completely organized by kids, our youth, and they have all received a President's Volunteer Service Award. They've all been signed by the President of United States, so I'm sure they are very proud about this achievement.
Well, it taught me a lot about leadership, especially how to manage my time a lot better, and it also taught me how to delegate work instead of doing everything by yourself, and it's taught me a lot about how to work in large group environments.
I volunteer for Vibha because I get to help the kids in India, and I feel like we have that special connection, and I feel you can't get that anywhere else, and there's just this special feeling that you get from Vibha and volunteering in general that you can't get anywhere else.
I went around my neighborhood and other neighborhoods asking people about if they wanted to sign up for the 5K by telling them that it's for a good cause and all.
So I've gone to Mumbai and I've seen the shelters and I've seen those kids and I've seen how they get treated outside and how we treat them inside and how much better their life is when we're in it. And I just want to be able to spread that impact as much as I can.
So what impact was it? I mean, what was the difference in their lives? Did they go back to the schools where they drop outs?
Yes, yeah, so a lot of them do succeed, and a lot of them, like, so we give them food, we give them shelter, they just live an overall better life. They get an education in like three different languages in Mumbai, and it's just a really great experience for them in terms of like building their just all of their life skills.
Great, thank you so much. So I'd just like to tell the viewers that we really welcome you to join Vibha. You can email us at volunteer@vibha.org, and you can join these kids, make a difference, kids making a difference in the lives of kids. That's what Vibha is all about, empowering kids, empowering anyone who wants to make a difference by joining us.
It's been a great experience. I'm really enjoying it. It's a great day. Obviously, coming out here to support Vibha, which is an amazing charity. It gives us a chance to do something for, you know, it's just some way to help, you know. And a great day, spend time with the family, and just be here.
Vibha is a non-profit organization. We've been helping kids in need for a very long time. We've been 25 years old now. We raise over $1 million a year. We invested around 17 million so far. And the big part about the organization is it's completely voluntary, volunteer driven. We have more than 2,000 volunteers, and we've done a phenomenal job. And right now, this New York, New Jersey area has done a phenomenal in the last 2 years. We've had many events, including blood drives, including the race, including Vibe, and just a spectacular turnout of people today. So very, very happy. And as you can see, a lot of people are here and enjoying the moment. But the most important thing, all the funds that we collect are going for children in India to make a brighter future for them. So that's where we are, and please help us grow. Hello.
Association, or AIA, is organizing a Diwali Mela at South Street Seaport this year during the first weekend in October. The AIA hosted its fundraising gala for Deepavali at Leonard's Palazzo on September 22nd.
I'm indeed honored to be here, and it is indeed a privilege. And I'm truly grateful for the award and really grateful for the honor. This means a lot, essentially, because your own community is the last to honor you, and it truly means a lot. I'm grateful to my family, I'm grateful to my friends, quite a few of them are here, so thank you very much for your support, your patience, and Mr. Nujal, I will be available for any kind of assistance to the AIA that you may require, so thank you very much.
And I'm really humbled by AIA Executive Committee to consider me for this ceremony. And then it was Bansir Shah who walked along the way to make me a successful entrepreneur. Apart from that, my UCI team had been with me for almost 20 years. And this award truly belongs to them.
The Association of Indians in America is such an organization, and the members of the association work diligently on behalf of causes and ideals which uphold the principles of human decency and brotherhood, and through the years you have demonstrated a selfless commitment to the community that warrants attention and gratitude. And whereas the County of Suffolk is proud of Nassau as well, is proud to extend this commendation to the association, as you are recognized for your invaluable service to the residents of Long Island. Congratulations.
Talk to me about your thoughts and feelings.
Oh, it's been great, actually. We had five wonderful honorees, and they were all accomplished, and we are proud to have them, proud to honor them, because they're really one of a kind and really accomplished. And also because it was a fundraising, there were a lot of other patrons, benefactors and supporters and hosts. So it was a wonderful event, and it was very successful.
This couple being recognized here at AIA not only shares their story for the community, it also inspires. And I want to move towards the secret.
I guess the secret really is that we really think our patients are our family. And if you think it that way, then you really, the care that you provide to your patients, it comes out from your heart. And you want to advise the right thing to your patient. You want to give them quality care. You want to give them time that they deserve and not be treated like a number. You want to be able to answer all their questions, their family's questions, because after all, they're coming to you with the problem. So I think our secret really is that we truly care about our patients. Patients is not a number. You want to do everything that you possibly can.
So then you have to do things in the within the limitation of the system. And indeed, there are a few things which are humanly possible, etc. But talk to me a little bit, Nileshji, about your vision. And not only vision is related to what you know about the possibilities, but it is also related to the kind of courage and, if I use the term, stamina that you have in terms of its scope.
So, Ashokji, when you really think about taking care of your patients, as Preeti mentioned, you don't want to be restricted by what people tell you what it is. You want to use, you want to be innovative and use technology, use a lot of resources, and be 100% committed. You don't want hospitals or insurance companies or other people to dictate what you do. You want to do what's best. So if someone comes to me for a problem, it's not about what I can offer, it's about what's best for them. And that is why you'll see such a difference in our practice compared to any other practice we have around. So if you were to come to me, and we actually are specialists in endoscopy and colonoscopy, if I could fix your problem with one pill and send you home, that is the happiest thing I would do. And I joke with my patients, I love you a lot, but I don't want to see you again. And in a nice way, that's what we truly do. I say, I love you so much that I don't want you to come to this office again.
And Bharat Patelji is one of the honoree here today at AIA. In your address also, there were some inspiring tidbits. Talk to me about being thoughtful in business or being emotional in business. Both go hand in hand.
I think business has got two aspects. One is money, which success makes the money, failure loses the money. There's another element, it's called a human element. Every business has got a human element associated with it. When you're successful, everybody's gonna be with you and around you. In your failure, people are gonna leave, and that's a snowball effect, means, you know, you literally die. So if you teach the people around you to be with you in success or failure or in between, then you can always come out of the cycle and make it happen. So that's the reason I said, when I said about always address your failure like I did something wrong, and always address your success like we did something good all together, that's the key.
I want you to share the secret how you manage to mingle and embrace community members at so many different events. Yesterday you were at Asia Society.
Well, I mean, I love the community, and I always believe that one has to be give back to the community, and that's what I'm doing it. I'm doing it with my time, my resources, financial resources, and with my media. The whole idea is to give back to the community. And I'm really enjoying it. It's a, for me, it's a adrenaline. I mean, it makes me very happy to see community grow and happy. You won't believe that I'm associated with the AIA since 1993. That is 30 years ago. And the first time they started Elephant Ride, and I was one of the sponsor of the ride for children. So I believe in this thing. And I truly enjoy this thing, and I urge everyone else to be part of the community and support the community.
So today there were some wonderful honorees. Some of the speeches were quite inspiring. Any impressions that you would carry from here?
Yeah, I mean, I see that what I was 40 years ago and what I was trying to achieve, I achieved 30, 40 years ago, I see in this young generation here, and it's a, and I'm very happy to see that our second generation is working hard, and they are excelling, and they are doing well.
Vision of Asia, a voice of the community, is offered with love and dedication for our community from ITV Gold. Watch your favorite show, Vision of Asia, every Monday through Thursday at 8 p.m. and the extended version with special highlights every Sunday at 11 a.m. right here on ITV Gold. It's now time for a short break. We'll return shortly. Indian music, dance performances, arts and crafts, as well as food were among the attractions of the Indian Association of Long Island's marquee event, the India Festival, which was held on Sunday, September 23rd at North Hempstead Beach Park in Port Washington, New York. Here's some highlights of the India Festival.
tera king oye lege aaya ring oye bad jani ajj meri queen tu us oye boyfriend bana le
kisi aur ko pata le
boyfriend bana le
nazre tu hata le
mujhko baza le
kisi aur ko pata le
The Share and Care Foundation organized Cooking for a Cause, an exciting competition for aspiring chefs. Iron Chef runner-up Jahangir Mehta was a judge at this event. Executive chefs Feroz Buhariwala, Hemant Mathur, Niti Sangranchka, Raja Janji and Sean Methani also supported this tasty initiative. Here's a report on the event by ITV Gold.
Today's event is for a cooking competition to have women empowerment awareness. This is the dream of the young girl Riya Mehta, and we have 31 participants, 4 categories: healthy item, non-veg entree, veg entree and desserts. And we have 5 judges.
Amazing to be at the Share and Care event, and I'm so proud that it was a very successful event with the food being fantastic and the participations of all these lovely women, and the force that they're working for is brilliant.
So my name is Pankaj Jaiswal and I'm with my daughter Shreya Jaiswal, and we have a hobby as our cooking hobby. What I have made is called Chicken Shan Nawabi. It's my own creation. The value of this dish is that you can use it for Thanksgiving to meet with the Indian palate. So I have roasted the whole chicken with the biryani inside. So it's a biryani made inside the chicken. Outside is a tandoori spice, and inside it's actually biryani spice. So it's a fusion of tandoori and biryani coming together. And I think since I have used like dry fruits in this, This is a chicken with nawabi, with lot of shan. So chicken shan nawabi. Thank you.
My friend, President Samar Saab, Mother Bhai, Suresh, all the Sharon Care members, I'm part of the Sharon Care since inception. So it's my family. This is my family. And to see a family starting a new initiative, it's a great thing. Why I'm saying it's a great initiative? Because this is an initiative will take you to second generation. See, look at the audience here. Most of the audience are in 40s and 50s, or most of the girls. So this is a great initiative. This will bring the more 40s and 50s in the shared care fold than any other initiative. So I must congratulate Sarat, Sirish, and Kanan for their great initiative. And as you know, I'm always with you. Only Khulbai Media is always with you. ITV is always with you. And whatever we are shooting today, it will be shown in India to 10 million subscribers through HWNN tomorrow. So you will be in India too. So that will be a great opportunity to be part of our coverage. So let's give big hand to all the cooking person and all the judges and my friend HR. Thank you.
So I'm happy that I met this organization. And other than that, I think we all had fun. It was just an overdose of food. When we were having that conversation first with Kanan, it was like 10 people have signed up, and I was like, how many do you think? And she says 30, and I'm like, nah, she's not going to get 30, and I mean, it's not going to happen. And then we got 31, I guess, right? And we really did go through all that, but we had fun. Some were close calls, some were different, and it was good to see that palette movement. And then there were some clear-cut winners. But main thing is, so long as you had fun, and the most important thing is, you raised money. And I think that's what we came for. It's not about winning, it's not about winning, it's not about losing. It's so long as we just came with the right belief. And all you young people, please vote.
We are so much thankful to Mr. Jangir Mehta, who normally does not have 1 minute to spare. But today, he spared no less than 4 hours with our foundation. Why? That will reach to many people who we have never been reached. Those families will be helped, and how much? In my judgment, at least we will reach 1,000 families. So Mr. Mehta, thank you so much. We appreciate
it. It was a pleasure. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Mehta.
Thank you very much.
This is today's event is Cooking for the Cause, where there were a lot of contestants and they have prepared fantastic food. They prepare from the home, but all the items were new. And you have to taste to believe it, what a fantastic item they were. And there were several judges. All judges have tasted the item, and they will declare the prize. All the contestants were given the certificate. Also, with this event, we have collected $15,000. Our annual gala, Sharon Care annual gala, is on October 20. Which is at Bergen Academy, Hackensack, New Jersey. This is a fantastic event where we generate lots and lots of donation to help the poor families in India. Here actually Javed Akhtar ji is coming. There will be 5 physicians and 5 musicians and 2 playback singers. And Javed Akhtar will select his own written song, and he will tell about the song, why it was written and what was the event behind it. So it is a unique program. We have collected already more than around $500,000 already, and we have collected advertisement and donations. But we want all the people, we want to fill the theater, which is has a 1200 capacity. So please join the cause. And our cause, three important. We do scholarship to the student. Sanitation department, there is a sanitation program, and also women empowerment program, and also help to the poor people in education. Thank you very much.
It's time to wind up today's Vision of Asia, Voice of the Community. Thanks for watching. Do follow us on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel of ITV Gold. Keep informing us of events by emailing us at events@itvgold.com. Until we meet again, have a great week ahead. I'm Kala Shankar. Namaste.